right, open the tank.
Stand by. I'm gonna open the tank and let him out.
Cerberus protocol is very clear regarding untested alien technology.
Do as I say, Aite.
I won't be second-guessed on my own ship by my own ship. Do it.
Very well, Shepard. The controls are online. The switch and consequences are yours.
Tch. Thanks for the reminder. Please don't kill me. I'm pretty defenseless at the moment. I would really should go here with full armor on. The perfect Krogan. Ooh! Oh, damn.
Human. Female.
Correct.
Before you die, I need a name.
You'll get more than that.
I'm Commander Shepard, and I don't take threats lightly. I suggest you relax.
Not your name. Mine. I'm trained. I know things. But the tank O'Kir couldn't implant connection. His words are hollow. Warlord, legacy, Grunt. Grunt. Grunt was among the last. It has no meaning. It'll do. I am Grunt. If you are worthy of your command, prove your strength and try to destroy me.
You want to die?
Why do you want me to try to kill you?
Want? I do what I'm meant to. Fight and reveal the strongest. Nothing in the tank ever asked what I want. I feel nothing for O'Kir's clan or his enemies. That imprint failed. He has failed. Without a reason that's mine, one fight is as good as any other. Might as well start with you.
Join my crew. We'll find it.
I have a good ship and a strong crew. A strong clan. You'd make it stronger.
If you're weak and choose weak enemies, I'll have to kill you.
Our enemies are worthy. No doubt about that.
That's acceptable. I'll fight for you.
I'm glad you saw reason.
Offer one hand, but arm the other. Why, Shepard? If I find a clan, if I find what I want, I will be honored to eventually pit them against you.
Thanks. What a guy. Oh my. I'll be honored to eventually pit them against me.
Shepard.
He's got upgrade things. What can you tell me about the collectors?
Did O'Kir give you any imprints about the collectors?
I see blurry ships, guesswork about strength. Nothing to help pick a weak spot and tear. O'Kir spent all his time on old hatreds. Whatever he had, it was used up when he made me.
And the mission?
What are your thoughts about our mission?
I fight. Doesn't matter who for.
And how do you like the squad, although you haven't met them yet?
What do you think about the crew?
Good bunch if they stay out of my way. Dead bunch if they don't. Train them good if you want to take on collectors. Some of these aliens are too smooth.
And upgrades.
Anything in your tank imprints that can make use of the resources we found?
Might have something I could put together. Don't know how useful it will be.
There might be some new stuff here. Actually, there's a new prototype, isn't there? A Krogan shotgun. More platinum. We need more ammo upgrades.
So I should keep this crap around? Don't let it pile up. I live down here.
I can't get him yet. I want to talk about you.
Just checking in. making sure you're acclimatizing.
Humans talk too much. Like the tank. Come back later.
Okay. That's all for now.
Shepard.
Some of the conversation options don't make sense because, checking up on him, we've already been there. Back to the bridge. I call it the bridge. What does she have to say
Commander,
now?
Commander, you've received a new message at your private terminal.
Thank you.
I don't know what to feel about Grunt. My psych reports refer Oak here. We have no guarantees that Grunt is mentally stable. I get the feeling he just doesn't care about anything, including who lives or dies.
That'll be all.
I'll be here if you need anything.
Thank you. Encrypted transmission from the elusive man. Shepard, I see you awaken Okir's Krogan. A dangerous decision, but you've got free rein on this operation. If you're certain he'll be a useful member on the team, you've got my support. We need every weapon we can get in this battle. If this Grunt proves unreliable and has to be put down, don't lose the body. He's based at least partially on collector technology and could offer useful genetic data. But again, you're in charge. Oh, we need to access the research terminal again, which is back here. And actually, back here. Well, I still can't get to it. Alright.
No messages for you, Commander.
Yeah, I know. I just read them. Let's hang out here and read a few entries. Just hold on one moment, because my nose keeps running. Okay. Let's see what we've got for entries here. You know what? Let's head back to my quarters anyway. I want to change this outfit. Favorite song playing. Choose this one. Alright, now we'll listen to some. Or read some. Stuff in the Codex. Okay, we've got some new primary stuff. With planets and locations and ships and vehicles.
Freedom's Progress.
Korlus.
Known as the Starcraft Cemetery, Korlus was the regional toxic junkyard for centuries. Ships reaching astronautical near-death at connecting mass relays were sent to Korlus, stripped of every useful component, then dumped planetward to clear shipping lanes. Currently, Korlus hosts numerous Merc factions, such as the Blue Suns, rumored to be using downed ship fossils to test advanced munitions. Massive gun batteries threaten anyone attempting planetfall, with minimal defenses against ground attack. Because ancient volcanism greenhoused the planet, Korlus was too hot and CO2 rich to develop a biosphere, despite the abundant lakes that could have sponsored the development of life. Now cool enough for protected habitation, but too scorching for anyone but extremophiles and mercenaries seeking secrecy, Korlus supports numerous Krogan outposts. The Krogan have therefore seeded Korlus with hardy vermin, often kept as warhounds. Aaron lived primarily on a diet of geophagous vermin and each other.
And each other. Okay, so the cannibals. Varin. We didn't come across any of them. Kinda glad. I don't like Varin that much. Extremophiles, though. That's a word I've never heard before. Ships and vehicles.
A Sari-made Cerberus armor can resist. Following the Battle of the Citadel, human and Turian volunteers conducted a massive 3-month recovery effort to clear the station's orbit of debris. Secretly, the Turian Office of Technological Reconnaissance volunteers were technology recovery specialists, salvaging the main weapon of the Geth flagship Sovereign and large amounts of its valuable Element Zero core. Contrary to popular belief, Sovereign's main gun was not a directed energy weapon. Rather, its massive Element Zero core powered an electromagnetic field, suspending a liquid iron uranium tungsten alloy that shaped into armor-piercing projectiles when fired. The jet of molten metal, accelerated to a fraction of the speed of light, destroys targets by impact force and irresistible heat. Only 11 months after the battle, the Turians produced the Thanix, their own miniaturized version of Sovereign's gun. The Thanix can fire reliably every 15 seconds, rivaling a cruiser's firepower, but mountable on a fighter or frigate.
5 seconds or 15? That's pretty cool, though. It's from Sovereign. Pretty awesome. Okay, caught up with primary once again, secondary. We just read this stuff and now they got new entries for non-council races. Krogan Blood Rage. Feared throughout the galaxy as nightmarishly violent warriors, the Krogan are both aided and hobbled by their legendary Blood Rage. In the grip of that madness, Krogan become seemingly invincible, but are merely totally unresponsive to pain. Blood-enraged Krogan fight regardless of injury level to the extent that Krogan shorn of all four limbs continue gnashing past brain death until total somatic death. The supremely resilient, hyper-violent Blood Rage is the synergy of two aspects of Krogan neurology. The first aspect is a positive feedback loop in which adrenaline, also activated by fear or rage, suppresses serotonin, the brain chemical that induces serenity. The second is the overdeveloped Krogan limbic system. In Krogan, as in humans, fear or rage shifts mental control from the frontal lobes, responsible for reasoning, to the limbic system, responsible for aggression and survival. During that shift, Krogans and humans exhibit diminished capacity for logic and self-control. Prior to the ecological devastation of Tuchanka, Blood Rage was extremely rare among the Krogan. Back then, while all Krogan were capable of heightened anger and violence in fight-or-flight scenarios, almost none experienced insensitivity to pain. The 1% who did were those suffering serotonin suppression. At that time, Krogan society regarded the condition as pathological, and medicated or imprisoned sufferers to protect them and society. Following nuclear ecocide 4 millennia ago, evolution selected only those Krogan afflicted with Blood Rage for survival. Today, there is no living memory among the Krogan of a life without mindless, murderous fury. Damn. Okay. On to new territory, non-sapient creatures. Husks. After the Geth secure a location, they round up and impale dead and living bodies on mechanical spikes. The spikes rapidly transform these victims into withered husks, extracting water and trace minerals and replacing them with cybernetics. The cybernetics reanimate the lifeless flesh and tissue, transforming the bodies into mindless killing machines. Some Alliance soldiers refer to the husk-generating spikes as dragon's teeth, a reference to the mythological berserkers who sprang up from the earth whenever the teeth of the dragon Ares were planted. Dragon's teeth and husks bear little resemblance to other pieces of Geth technology. No one is sure why a synthetic race would bother to drain the minuscule amount of recoverable resources from organic corpses, though the value of reusing them as shock troops is obvious. Thresher Maws. Thresher Maws are subterranean carnivores that spend their entire lives eating or searching for something to eat. Threshers reproduce via spores that can lie dormant for millennia, yet are robust enough to survive prolonged periods in deep space, and atmospheric re-entry. As a result, Thresher spores appear on many worlds, spread by previous generations of space travelers. The body of a Thresher never entirely leaves the ground. Only the head and tentacles erupt from the earth to attack. In addition to physical attacks, Threshers have the ability to project toxic chemicals and emit bursts of infrasound as a shockwave weapon. Well, I've heard of ultrasound, but infrasound, huh? The Alliance first encountered Threshers on the colony of Akuz in 2177. After contact was lost with the Pioneer team, marine units were deployed to investigate. The shore parties were set upon by hungry Threshers, and nearly the entire assault force was killed. Alliance forces recommend engaging Threshers with vehicle-mounted heavy weapons. And Varan. Varan are omnivores with a preference for living prey. Originally native to the Krogan homeworld of Tuchanka, they are, like most life from Tuchanka, savage, clannish, and consummate survivors. They are pack hunters when vulnerable prey is readily available, and become scavengers when outnumbered or outclassed. Their supreme adaptability, vicious demeanor, and rapid breeding cycle have made them ubiquitous and dangerous pests on many worlds. Virtually everywhere the Krogan have been, Varan infestations have followed, wreaking havoc with the native ecology. Wow. The Krogan have had a love-hate relationship with Varan for millennia, alternately fighting them for territory and embracing them as treasured companions. To this day, Krogan raised them as beasts of war. A common subgenus of Varan has metallic silver scales, leading to their rather unusual nickname, fish dogs. Cerberus Project Overlord. Planet Aite? Two beautiful moons, one spectacular ring, zero neighbors, says a popular advertisement for this Terminus system's world. Aite is known for its sparsely settled population, despite being a garden planet with a colony nearly a century old. Blessed with a mild climate, wildlife no more dangerous than that of Earth, and soil and bacteria amenable to imported plants, Aite would appear to be an unexplored paradise. However, it is unpopular for two reasons. The first and most obvious is that its moon, Aite, is in an unstable orbit that will lead to a planetary impact and an extinction-level event within the next two centuries. As such, all investment in the planet is short-term, and the biggest business is selling off the local biota to the highest bidder. The second drawback is the level of violence on the planet. Like the rest of the Thanix massing cluster, Aite was briefly considered part of Citadel space during its first wave of colonization. However, when the colony broke off to become an independent planet in 2133, the Council let the doomed planet go with less than a day of debate. Free from any real governing body, Aite's history has since been filled with wars between small frontier town city-states over its resources. The result is a dangerous world where the average citizen is expected to be self-reliant to the point of fending for themselves against cutthroat corporations, strong-armed militia groups, and even Geth incursions. The fighting is so frequent that the name of the planet itself has changed more than 11 times. In a sign of blunt indifference, standard Citadel Galaxy Standard Citadel Galaxy maps refer to the world by the name given it to it by human colonists in the latter half of the century. Which I guess would be Aite? And then you drink real fast, guys. Okay, Citadel and Galactic Government. A whole bunch. Let's see if we can just finish this section. Battle of the Citadel. In 2183, a rogue specter named Saren Artarius attacked the Citadel through a functioning mass relay hidden inside a statue in the Presidium. Saren brought a combined force of Krogan and Geth infantry from Ilos, timing the attack so that he would be at the Citadel's controls when the Geth fleet and his flagship, Sovereign, arrived. In the battle that followed, the Destiny Ascension Dreadnought evacuated the Citadel Council, but ordered the ward's arms closed, sealing them and the Geth inside an impregnable shell, cutting off any reinforcements or escape. This combative tactic would have wholly destroyed the Council fleet, were it not for the actions of Commander Shepard, who had followed Saren through the relay from Ilos. Led by Shepard's ship Normandy, the System Alliance's 5th Fleet assembled under the command of Admiral Hackett and waited just outside the Citadel's closed arms. Meanwhile, Shepard fought Saren's forces inside the Citadel and eventually forced the ward arms open again. Shepard called for the Normandy to concentrate firepower on Sovereign. The 5th Fleet took its cue from the Normandy and turned all firepower on the Geth flagship, letting the Destiny Ascension and other fleeing Council ships perish fighting the Geth fleet. At about the same time Shepard killed Saren, Sovereign's once impervious kinetic barrier overloaded, and the 5th Fleet focused its military might to shatter the flagship. The Geth fleet was soon decimated without its leader. With the Citadel Council and nearly everyone in its line of succession killed, humanity stepped into the power vacuum. Ambassador Donald Odina and Captain David Anderson were instrumental in pulling together a new galactic government with humans as the dominant voice. This seems kind of selfish of us not to include them in the council. So, I don't know. I could see how the other races don't like it very much. I wouldn't either if I were them. Citadel Conventions. These diplomatic talks occurred in the wake of the Krogan rebellions as a response to the destruction of the conflict and an attempt to distance the Council from the brutal Krogan warfare. The conventions regulate the use of weapons of mass destruction. A WMD causes environmental alteration to a world. A bomb that produces a large crater is not considered a WMD. A bomb that causes a nuclear winter is. Use of WMD is forbidden on garden worlds like Earth, with ecospheres that can readily support a population. If a habitable world is destroyed, it will not be replaced for millions of years. The conventions do not forbid the use of WMD on hostile worlds or in sealed space station environments. Many militaries continue to develop and maintain stockpiles. I could only imagine a nuclear bomb going off inside a space station. That would be horrible. The conventions graded weapons of mass destruction into tiers of concern. Tier 1 is the greatest threat to galactic peace. Tier 1, large kinetic impactors such as asteroid drops or deorbiting space stations. Effectively free and available in any system, in the form of debris left over from planetary accretion, kinetic impactors are the weapon of choice for terrorists and third galaxy nations. Tier 2. Uncontrolled self-replicating weapons, such as nanotechnology, viral or bacteriological organisms, von Neumann devices, and destructive computer viruses. These weapons can lie dormant for millennia, waiting for a careless visitor to carry them on to another world. Tier 3. Large energy burst weapons, such as nuclear or antimatter warheads. Tier 4. Alien species deliberately introduced to crowd out native forms necessary for the health of an ecosystem. Ecological tampering can take years to bear fruit, making it difficult to prove. Citadel Council. The Council is an executive committee composed of representatives from the Asari Republics, the Turian Hierarchy, and the Salarian Union. Though they have no official power over the independent governments of other species, the Council's decisions carry great weight throughout the galaxy. No single Council race is strong enough to defy the other two, and all have a vested interest in compromise and cooperation. Well, this is the old Council, right? Each of the Council species has general characteristics associated with the various aspects of governing the galaxy. The Asari are typically seen as diplomats and mediators. The Salarians gather intelligence and information. The Turians provide the bulk of the military and peacekeeping forces. Any species granted an embassy on the Citadel is considered an associate member, bound by the accords of the Citadel Conventions. Associate members may bring issues to the attention of the Council, though they have no input on a decision. The Human Systems Alliance became an associate member of the Citadel in 2165. Drink. Citadel Space. Citadel space is an unofficial term referring to any region of space controlled by a species that acknowledges the authority of the Citadel Council. At first glance, it appears this territory encompasses most of the galaxy. In reality, however, less than 1% of the stars have been explored. Even Mass Effect FTL Drive is slow relative to the volume of the galaxy. Empty space and systems without suitable drive discharge sites are barriers to exploration. Only the mass relays allow ships to jump hundreds of light years in an instant, the key to expanding across an otherwise impassable galaxy. Whenever a new relay is activated, the destination system is rapidly developed. From that hub, FTL drive is used to expand to nearby star clusters. The result is a number of densely developed clusters thinly spread across the vast expanse of space connected by the mass relay network. Citadel Security Services, or CSEC. Citadel Security is a volunteer police service answering to the Citadel Council. The 200,000 constables of CSEC are responsible for maintaining public order in the densely populated Citadel. They also provide pirate suppression, customs enforcement, and search and rescue throughout the Citadel cluster. CSEC has 6 divisions. Enforcement: uniformed officers who patrol the Citadel and respond to emergencies. Investigation: detectives who puzzle out the truth behind crimes and bring perpetrators to justice. Customs: screens the thousands of passengers and cargo containers that pass through the Citadel's ports every day. Network: deals with cybercrimes like identity and copyright theft, hacking and viral attacks, and illegal artificial intelligence. Special Response: deals with hostage situations, bombs, and heavily armed criminals. In the unlikely event that attackers board the Citadel, they are also the front line of defense, armed with military-grade equipment. Patrol: naval arm with ships stationed throughout the Citadel cluster. Unlike the other divisions, they are rarely seen at the Citadel, nor do they stay in one place long. Joining CSEC is prestigious. Applications must be sponsored by a Citadel Councilor, or the ambassador of an associate council race. Generally, applicants have many years of distinguished service in the military or police forces of their nation, but an inexperienced applicant with demonstrable talent will be fairly considered. CSEC and the Spectres are often at odds. Many CSEC members, notably current Executor Venari Palin, believe that allowing Spectres to be above the law is a dangerous practice. The actions of Saren Artarius lead credence to this position. The Spectres, in turn, are aggravated when CSEC's dedication to procedure and due process hampers their investigations. Foundations: the undersides of the wards, between the inhabited superstructures and impenetrable outer hull, are called the Foundations. Oh, cool, we haven't seen that. These dangerous areas are filled with life support systems and power plants. Officially, only the Keepers are allowed in the Foundations. In reality, the Foundations are the slums of the Citadel, home to criminals, minorities, transits, and occasional stateless exiles. Some stay in the Foundations of their own will. Others end up there when the opportunities they sought in the Citadel do not come. This is very similar to Babylon 5's Down Below. The station's recycling systems are located in the Foundations. These manufacture a variety of artificial organic pastes that can be eaten for substances. They are free and nutritious, but nearly tasteless and of unpleasant texture. Poorer Citadel residents quickly become adept at dressing up this bland fare with sauces and spices, while imported foodstuffs are a popular luxury of the wealthy. Really, again, like Babylon 5, I don't remember who it was, but there was somebody who had smuggled seeds or fruits or something like that, and was growing a plant in the hydroponics bay, and technically against the rules, but the security would, look the other way. I think they might have gotten some of the fruit or vegetables, as a bribe. Presidium Ring. The ring is an enclosed loop of park-like space serving as the connection point for the wards. The interior walls are lined with the embassies of influential species and private residences for the galaxy's elite. The Presidium is full of open-air restaurants, bars, and luxurious meeting areas. Gravity is about one-third Earth normal. A holographic sky is projected over the ceiling of the ring. Unlike the 24/7 bustle of the wards, the Presidium maintains a 20-hour day schedule, with a 6-hour night where lights are dimmed and the sky goes through a night cycle. Surprise, 6 hours. Why not make it 8? You know, that's generally what humans need. But, then again, the Citadel was not created with human beings in mind. Offices and residences are often open to the interior. It is not unusual for embassies to have no exterior wall at all. This does not cause a crime problem due to the heavy CSEC presence and ubiquitous monitoring devices on the Presidium. Thieves are quickly identified and apprehended. The ring is the location of the Citadel's spaceports. Being closer to the center of spin, there is less motion for a ship to match, and the reduced spin gravity makes handling cargo easier. Hundreds of ships pass through the Citadel every day, and every species with an embassy is granted a private dock. The tower, at the center of the ring, holds the administration of the Citadel Council. The tower rises over a kilometer from the ring, appearing to thrust forward parallel to the ward arms. As the tower is at the center of the spin axis, it experiences little centrifugal force. Gravity is maintained using mass effect fields at a 90-degree angle to the ring and wards. A consular dock can be found at the base of the tower. While normally used for diplomatic couriers and Spectre business, the shuttles docked here can evacuate the Council government in an emergency. Serpent Nebula. The Citadel is surrounded by a blue-tinted reflection nebula. The light of the nebula is actually light from the Citadel, scattered and reflected back at the station. At first, the Serpent Nebula was assumed to be made of microscopic construction debris. Prevailing theory holds that the Protheans used molecular nanotechnology to manufacture the incredibly durable materials used in the Citadel. But unlike other nebula, the Serpent does not dissipate over time. Therefore, it must be replenished constantly. The current popular theory is that the non-recyclable waste collected by the Citadel's keepers is somehow rendered down to the atomic or molecular level and ejected into the cloud. Really? The thick nebula presents a navigation hazard. Beyond the relatively clear areas around the Citadel, electrical discharges are common. These are not blocked by kinetic barriers and can severely damage metal-frame starships. In addition, some dense knots of dust can overwhelm the repulsion of kinetic barriers on smaller ships. If such a vessel is moving fast enough at the time, the effects are similar to being hit by a sand blaster. So why do we need this nebula? Attempting to reach the Citadel through open space navigation is unadvisable. The only safe approach is through the various mass relays that orbit it. Well, yeah, true. I guess that makes it safer. Gotta use the mass relay. Dangerous to come in, you know, the other way, so... kinda keeps things a little safer from being... an invasion. But... yet Saren came through the mass relay, so that didn't work there. Citadel Station Statistics. Yeah, almost done. Although the Citadel is equipped with mass effect generating element zero cores, most of the gravity on the station is generated by the centrifugal force of rotation. So it's 3.5 minutes per revolution, the rotation. Rotational gravity in the wards, 1.02 Earth, and in the Presidium, 0.3 Earth. Here's the length diameter, ward length, ward width. I'm not going to read all that. Exterior armor thickness 13 meters. Population 13.2 million, not including keepers. Gross weight is 7.11 billion metric tons. And the height of the Presidium Tower is 1,047 meters. The wards. The majority of the Citadel's population lives in the wards, the five massive arms of the station that house the residential and commercial districts. Many galactic races have established cultural enclaves here. Excuse me, wow, I need a drink. Population density and cost of living are extremely high, akin to Earth cities such as Hong Kong and Singapore. The wards are open top with skyscrapers rising from the superstructure. Towers are sealed against vacuum as the breathable atmosphere envelope is only maintained to a height of about 7 meters. The atmosphere is contained by the centrifugal force of rotation and a membrane of dense, colorless sulfur hexafluoride gas held in place by carefully managed mass effect fields. The view from the wards is spectacular. In the background, stars, Serpent Nebula, and the nearby blue giant called the Widow move across the sky as the station rotates to stabilize itself. In the foreground, the lights of buildings and vehicles on the opposing ward arms perpetually shine. The Citadel has no real day or night. While the station keeps to standard galactic time for political functions, businesses rarely close and residents acclimate to sleep and work according to personal need rather than a day-night cycle. Additions and modifications are constantly being constructed, though they must stay within certain specifications that will not compromise the operation of the station. Occasionally, the keepers will descend on an area of the wards and move or change the architecture without explanation. Residents have learned to live with these inexplicable intrusions. And the Treaty of Phyrexian? Due to the destructive potential of dreadnoughts, the Council races agreed at the Phyrexian Naval Conference to fix a ratio of dreadnought construction between themselves. At the top of the period is the peacekeeping Turian fleet. Below the Turians are the other Council races, currently the Asari and Salarians. Council associate races are at the bottom. The Human Systems Alliance is part of this last group. The ratio of Turian to Council to associate dreadnoughts is 5-3-1. For every dreadnought humans are permitted to build, the Asari have 3 and the Turians 5. So we still have all this. Thanks for watching, everyone. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.